Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the integrated routing and bridging feature of an EVPN VXLAN topology. If you like my content so far and you're interested in seeing more networking and telecom technologies simply explained, then please subscribe now to the channel. And when you do subscribe, make sure to enable notifications like so that you'll be informed of new content. If you like this video, make sure to click that thumbs up button. So far, we've gone through several videos talking about both layer 2 and layer 3 operations in VXLAN. Integrated routing and bridging, or IRB, in the context of VXLAN, simply refers to the capability of the VTEP devices to perform layer 2 switching, or bridging, as well as layer 3 routing. Now, VXLAN is used to span layer 2 segments across the VXLAN topology. These layer 2 segments can be present in many VTEPs, as shown here. Here we have 4 VTEPs with hosts on the 6501 VNI. Now, in a production environment, you may have a single VNI present on dozens, or in extreme cases, on hundreds of VTEPs. So it's not immediately clear where in this whole topology routing is to be performed. If one of these PCs, for example, wants to communicate with PC5 here, which is in a different VNI, where would routing take place? It must take place on a VTEP because routing must take place in the VXLAN overlay network. And it's the VTEPs that serve this overlay network. But which VTEP will actually do the routing? Now, to discuss this issue, we first have to define two terms, the ingress VTEP and the egress VTEP. Now, the ingress VTEP is defined as the starting point of a VXLAN tunnel, where a packet enters the VXLAN overlay. The ingress VTEP encapsulates the Ethernet frame into a VXLAN header and forwards it into the VXLAN network. Now, the egress VTEP is the endpoint of the VXLAN tunnel, where the packet exits the VXLAN network and gets forwarded to the destination Ethernet network. The egress VTEP is the one that decapsulates the VXLAN packet. In other words, it removes the VXLAN header and forwards that packet to the appropriate destination. Now, having clarified this terminology, we can now talk about two specific implementations of IRB. We have asymmetric and symmetric integrated routing and bridging. What does asymmetric IRB look like? Well, asymmetric IRB is implemented when the ingress VTEP is configured to perform both bridging and routing, while the egress VTEP is configured to perform only bridging. To see what this means practically, we can take a look at this diagram. Here we have two VNIs, 6501 and 6502. We have a couple of SVIs that we've configured at each VTEP, and they are using Anycast IP addresses. For more about Anycast gateways for VXLAN, take a look at my related video. You can find a link in the description below. So when PC1 wants to send a packet to PC2, it sends it to the default gateway, which is the SVI here. At VTEP 1, both bridging and routing will take place. So the packet is routed, and inter-VNI routing will forward that packet from SVI VLAN 12 to SVI VLAN 13. It will then be placed on VNI 6502 and sent along its way. When it reaches the egress VTEP, which is VTEP 2, only bridging will take place here. And that's fine because we're already on VNI 6502. So without any layer 3 routing, the VTEP will forward the packet to PC2. Now on the way back, VTEP 2 is the ingress VTEP and VTEP 1 is the egress VTEP. So routing and bridging will take place on VTEP 2. Thus the packet will be routed to the default gateway, which is SVI 13. Inter-VNI routing will forward that to the VLAN 12 SVI, and the packet will be forwarded on VNI 6501 to VTEP 1. We are now at the egress VTEP, which is VTEP 1, and thus only bridging will take place. So the packet is then forwarded to PC1 on VNI 6501. So why is this called asymmetric IRB? Because the return traffic uses a different VNI than the source traffic. This requires that both the source and destination VNIs be associated with both the ingress and egress VTEPs. So even if you don't have any end devices on VTEP 2 that belong to VNI 6501, you still have to create an SVI on VTEP 2 to handle the routing to VNI 6501. So what this means, more broadly speaking, is that every VTEP must be associated with every VNI on your VXLAN topology to which you would like to have layer 3 communication, even if you don't have any end devices on that VNI on your local VTEP. Now, you can easily see how this can not only be cumbersome to configure, but it's also not scalable. Now, the alternative is symmetric IRB. Now, believe it or not, we've already seen this in previous videos, but we haven't actually called it symmetric IRB. Remember, in symmetric IRB, routing and bridging takes place at both the ingress and the egress VTEPs. In order to achieve this, it makes use of the transit VNI that we have mentioned before. This is a VNI that's created to carry all inter-VNI traffic between VTEPs. Now, in this scenario, if PC1 communicates with PC2, its packet will be sent to the default gateway, which is the VLAN 12 SVI, and it will then be routed to the SVI associated with our transit VNI of 6500, which is SVI 1213. Bridging now takes place, sending the traffic across VNI 6501, where it will reach VTEP 2. Now, routing will take place again, routing from SVI 1213 to SVI 13, and then bridging will take place by forwarding the packet to PC2. On the way back, a similar process takes place where the packet is sent to SVI 13, routed to SVI 1213, and switched across the transit VNI of 6500. Once VTEP 1 is reached, routing will take place again from SVI 1213 to SVI 12, and then the packet will be switched to PC1. Now notice here that the same VNI is traversed between VTEPs in both directions, and that's why it's called symmetric IRB. Now notice also that in symmetric IRB, VTEP 2 here doesn't need to be associated with the VNI serving PC1. Indeed, it can be completely oblivious to that VNI's existence. And that is the benefit of symmetric IRB. Now here's another example that throws an additional setup into the mix. Here we have added PC3, which exists on VNI 6501, but it's connected to VTEP 2. If PC1 wants to communicate with PC3, which is on the same subnet, on the same VNI, no routing will take place, nor will the transit VNI of 6500 be used. Only bridging will take place across VNI 6501. For this reason, VNI 6501 does exist across the VXLAN topology and on both VTEPs 1 and 2. And both VTEPs 1 and 2 are associated with this VNI. However, because VNI 6502 exists only on VTEP 2, VTEP 1 can remain completely oblivious to it and still allow communication between PC2 on VNI 6502 and PC1 on VNI 6501. So until now, we've been configuring a transit VNI wherever we wanted to employ routing in a VXLAN topology. Initially, it may have seemed superfluous, but now you know why it is preferable. Because in this way, symmetric IRB can be employed, which is more scalable and more intuitive than asymmetric IRB. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates of newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecom tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.